Good morning to everybody. This session will be about ROBO scenario, and the title of the session was From Design to the Practice, which kind of design trying to using VCDX methodology, and which kind of practice, some kind of practice that I've done in this year on the field, so practical experience in different scenarios, also this one. I'm Andrea Mauro, I'm from the Italian VMUG, this is a community session, so thank you to be here, to listen to me. Sorry for my English, it's not my primary language, so I try to do my best, that probably is worst for you, but think that I'm not native on this language. So, what is VCDX methodology? I think that most of you already know some about this. If you have tried to apply to VCDX, to some level of VCDX in some part of the path of the VCDX certification, or also if you just attend at VMworld or book, buy some book from VCDX number one, or what else. There are a lot of sources on how to make a good design and transform them to good project that can be useful, of course, if you try to do VCDX certification, but also if you just want to make your job better and your project better. So the steps are basically starting from discovering the inputs, try to figure out which are the requirements, the constraints, the risks. There can be some assumption, but other risks that can be introduced by this kind of assumptions. And then try to match all these requirements, all these input in some kind of design, starting from logical design, from a conceptual design, logical design, and then bring to a physical design. The path is almost clear and well known for several type of user cases. For example, for cloud architecture, there are some good reference for vCloud Director. Also now, there are some good reference on building big vSphere environments using, for example, also NSX for network virtualization. All those documents came from this kind of approach, trying to make something general, of course, because it is not specific for one customer, and then make a good project considering all those aspects. There are different point of view, of course. There are different steps. I like this post from René, because maybe I don't agree in all part, but he points the fact that you have to be pragmatic. Okay, there are a lot of high-level aspects, but you have to focus on them, but sometimes you have also to make it works, make the physical design, make a good physical design, and so you have to be, you need a balance design, balance implementation, maybe in this weight, maybe not, doesn't matter, but you have to make all of this stuff working good and to build them in the right way to have a final good project. Of course, on the technical aspect, you have to focus on different layer. You have the virtualization layer, the storage layer, the computing, that is the virtualization, maybe mixed with the storage in hyperconverged, the network layer, and so on, and look at different aspects that are typical in each design that you can do and each project that you can do at enterprise level, at least availability, manageability, and so on. So you have to mix and match all these aspects and trying to find some kind of solution that can fit your specific case. What is ROBO? ROBO is a remote office, branch office, that mostly is something small at local level, because on a site, on a branch, you may have a really small size company, but is only a part of the company. So you cannot use generic SMB solution for this kind of scenario, because at the global level is an enterprise solution. And probably it needs enterprise level services or availability level or so on. So you have to think in a big way, because it's not just a bunch of small offices. No, you have to manage also them. So there are several different aspects that you have to consider. At a high level, in the input, validation, and collection, for sure you have some kind of requirements that maybe seems easy. But you have to focus on scalability, because in a different way, it's not a scalability on a site level, probably because the site will be just small and don't need to scale. But at the global level, you have to build a good building block that can scale and be replicated as is as possible to make the number of all your site. So at the global level, you have at least to scale. For sure, you need to have something repeatable, because if in each branch you build something different, can be difficult to manage, to provide a good solution, because if each solution is different, you can have an issue, could be replicated on the other site, you don't know. If you use different storage solution, you have multiple solutions to manage, so can be complicated. If it's really a building block that you can just multiply for all your site, can be easy. There are some constraints. Budget is a constraint, because you have to focus at the cost, because this cost will be multiplied. So it's not just is a small difference. It's a small difference that can be 10 times, 20 times. It depends by the number of the remote offices. So if you try to do something that can fit in, can be optimized from the cost point of view, can be really useful for this kind of scenario. Another aspect that you have to consider that can be a constraint, but also a huge risk, is that in each branch office, probably you don't have IT people that can manage something. Probably all the IT people are on the central office. So this is really important to be considered, because manageability, for example, should be something that can be centralized. Otherwise, it's not easy, because those branch office could be also really far one from one another. From the risk, the IT is one risk, but also you have to consider bandwidth, latency across those offices, because this can be one huge risk from the point of central manageability, or also from the point of view of some implementation. If you don't have reasonable bandwidth or low latency across those offices, there can be some issue, and your implementation can be good from a logical point of view, but cannot work at physical level. Of course, security. We have talked in the keynote the security aspect. Each remote office can have part of the data, can have some kind of replicated data from the central office also, can be a huge security risk. You have to find some kind of solution at application or infrastructure level, otherwise you can be really exposed because maybe the central office is strong enough from the security point of view, but from one remote office you can start your attack, as I explained this morning. Of course, you have also to consider how weak can be a remote office from the, not only from the IT people, but from the point of view of the IT facility, like the cooling infrastructure that maybe there aren't. You have a dedicated room? Maybe not. So, is you have a rack? Maybe not. It really depends. You have to evaluate all of them, because your physical solution cannot be something that does not consider also this aspect. So let's start from the availability aspect. We see the sum of the high level aspect that are few, but there are already some huge risks that you have to analyze, and don't make simple assumption, because maybe you can fail in your project if you make simple assumption. Just consider all of them. From the availability point of view, a remote office should have right availability. How? Let's see. Networking maybe is the weakest one, because small office just can have one switch, maybe a low speed switch, does not have correct network redundancy, maybe have right network redundancy for the connection with the main office, but locally, the local area network can be really weak. You have to consider this, because your infrastructure maybe can rely on this. Let's see what's happened with vSphere HA. If network is not reliable on the management network, it's a mess. Does not work really well. You have an isolated situation. So network can be really, really important, and you have to consider it. Storage, of course, is important. For different aspects, you have to consider, if you have some kind of local data, you need to have data availability in some kind of a way. Doesn't matter. You need a good data availability. Your storage infrastructure maybe can have some issue, but you still need to have your data, and probably to don't lose your data. That is another aspect really, really important. So this is most on data protection, but also on data availability. Usually, this level of availability can be reasonable, but maybe higher. It depends by your business. Of course, all is driven by business needs. From compute, it depends how many server or virtual machine or what else do you really need. So the power and the redundancy, it really depends on the number of server and, of course, the business needs and the budget that you can have. A single host is can be cheap, but is weak from the availability point of view. The some parts, also if you use redundancy for disks, for power supply, the motherboard is a single point of failure, the processor are a single point of failure, memory can be a single point of failure unless you don't use costly memory with bank redundancy. So of course, virtualization is a solution, but you have to start at least with two physical systems for your computing. And for the workload point of view, you have to check and verify if your workload are designed to be available, because you can have some kind of workload that has an intrinsic availability feature, like, for example, Active Directory domain controllers that can be more and just use this kind of redundancy, or Exchange DAG, or something else. And of course, if are designed to fail in a transparent way, that can be useful. From manageability, which kind of aspect do you have to consider? Of course, the limited IT people and facility that you have in a remote office can be a limit. So a good reasonable choice is usually to have some kind of central management, if you can. But central management requires a minimum bandwidth to work, a maximum latency to work reasonable. It depends by the service that you are using. For example, with vCenter, you can use a central vCenter, of course, but if you have a latency more than 500 milliseconds, it's not so good to work with a central vCenter. Bandwidth can be not a huge risk, unless you are trying to deploy a template from a central repository. In this case, you can have some issue. But for usual manageability, it's not an issue. Latency, and if you have some packet drop, can be a big issue, because hosts can be disconnected when they respond too late, or they don't respond at all for too much time. And this can be a problem if you are starting some operation. Of course, you probably know that most of the feature of vSphere can be started from vCenter, but then can finish themselves also without vCenter. That's great, because we can have enough resiliency also if for some minutes we don't have the vCenter connectivity. Otherwise, the other solution is going to multiple vCenter, but it's not so easy to manage, honestly, because you have a limited number of linked vCenter. If you want to use linked mode, you can have a limited number, but also to use linked mode, you need a vCenter standard that is not cheap at all. Multiple instances of vCenter standard can be really costly if you multiply for 20 or more for the number. For storage and backup, it depends by the solution, but of course also in this case, you need to consider which kind of central solution, central manageability solution you can have. And of course also for hardware, depending by the type of hardware, you can have out-of-band management and several tools to handle multiple out-of-band management system in one central station. Performance can be not so important, because usually the number of the system that you have in a robo scenario, so we don't spend too much on this. For the networking, 1 giga can be enough. It depends, but can be enough usually. We can use cross cable, maybe, maybe not, it depends. For storage, how many virtual machine, if you are we are going to virtual machine, can we handle on a single hard disk? It depends, of course, but by the number of IOPS of each workload. But usually we can consider through 2-3 virtual machine on 10 reasonable performance virtual machine on one disk. Of course, with SSD, all can be changed, then performance can not be an issue. But just with four, three, it depends by the number of the virtual machine disk, we can have enough performance at storage level. Cache can be useful, but not necessary. And of course, CPU and RAM, it depends what we really need. For CPU, we can also consider one socket solution that can be useful if we have a license based on socket. Otherwise, maybe not, but we can consider also this kind of aspect because in one socket, we can have enough core to run really, really well. So which kind of infrastructure we can usually found at a remote office? In one case, nothing. We have enough bandwidth, low latency, so there is nothing at all at a remote office. In this case, it's not interesting for the rest of the presentation because it's just one centralized system with some remote networking, but nothing else. But we need a really good bandwidth. Availability of the bandwidth is critical and can be a risk. Bandwidth can be a risk. Latency can be a huge, huge risk in this, of course. Another case is have one, two, a really few number of servers that maybe can fail. We can have a local Active Directory domain controller, maybe configured as a read-only domain controller, but just for optimize the login operation and something else. If we lose this, there isn't a big issue because there is still one or two in the central office. We can have a local share that is DFS, for example. If this fail, doesn't matter, it's a DFS, so we can have a secondary DFS link that is in the central office and we can still work, not so fast as using local resources, but we have designed all the remote office to have some services that can simply fail. They are useful to optimize the performance and the locality of the data, but are not necessary to make business work reasonable. This is important because in this case we can have also virtual machine, but on a really small system that can fail at infrastructure level. Otherwise, we can have some kind of server with limited availability, but is difficult, or we have some server, some services that require reasonable availability. Okay, this will be the last aspect, but let's consider the third and the second case. We can implement this case with at the smallest, easy, cheapest way, just using a NAS. There are some NAS that can provide some kind of service also to make data replication and so on, and also running a virtual machine on it. We just need two virtual machine, read-only domain controller, just the DFS part for use then the share of the NAS. Yes, it can be a solution, really, really cheap for a really small remote office, but we need to have all the workloads that can fail. Otherwise, this can fail for sure, and we lose everything. Usually, we are looking for something that at infrastructure level has a good availability. So, which kind of solution we will use? Normally, vSphere with some kind and some physical servers, some hosts, two, three more, usually two are enough because in a remote office, unless we have, for example, VDI with local virtual desktop, the number of servers are really limited. Two good ESXi hosts can handle everything. Honestly, also one can handle everything, but does not provide the right availability level. So for the license point of view, which kind of license should we use? If you have really few VM, it doesn't really make sense use something different from the ROBO license, because also with 10 VM, ROBO license can be cheaper than using the Essential Plus. And the Essential Plus does not provide the central management, because the vCenter is an essential vCenter that cannot be linked, can be in the primary office, yes, but you need multiple instances of one vCenter essential for each office. It's a mess from a management point of view. With ROBO, you don't have the vCenter license, of course, you have to pay for this. You can use the same if you have a vCenter standard license for your local infrastructure, but finally you have a central point where you can manage everything. For Windows, of course, you need some kind of Windows license in the proper way. Just remember that the new Windows Server is licensed also on the cores, so you have a limit in the total amount of cores on a physical host. And then you have to find some kind of license for the storage, depending on the storage. Some kind of storage can be licensed for socket in hyperconverged or in virtual storage per terabyte or just for the appliance on what you need. And backup also, you have to find something. For server, there are different form factors that you can consider, but I don't want to spend much time on this. On storage, you can find local storage, but maybe, unless you are using some kind of hyperconverged solution, does not provide a reasonable availability. But still, if you have some kind of relaxed availability level, you can just do replication of VM across one node to another node, and from the second to the first, just to have some kind of RPO and RTO of your infrastructure. Can be useful, yes. Can be for all, probably not, depending on business needs, of course. You can have an external storage. Which kind of storage? It depends, but honestly, for really few hosts, the shared SaaS solution is, from my point of view, the best solution, because you don't need external switches, neither Ethernet or fiber channel switches. You can have really good performance. If you see the numbers, SaaS storage can go faster than an iSCSI at 10 gigabit because of the standard of the SaaS. Of course, cannot scale to more than usually 4 nodes. It depends by the storage. But it is still another block in your office. Maybe you want to optimize the space that you are using. So probably other solution like hyperconverged solution or converged solution can be enough. There are also some good convergent solutions like the Dell Vertex that is just one tower that is usable to be stocked everywhere, can work with fresh air, so does not require a strictly cooling system, work with normal supply cable, normal PDU, and include all the shared storage and 4 nodes, up to 4 nodes, to build your infrastructure. Maybe it's too costly for a small office, but can be interesting if you have a medium number of workload in an office. probably not for Robo, but for big branch office can be interesting for sure. Otherwise, the hyperconverged solution, I think that everybody here know what is an hyperconverged solution. That is good for a remote office because you have just two can be enough, servers with local storage, with networking, with the virtualization part, and you can handle this as a completely hyperconverged solution to build your infrastructure for the branch office. Which kind of design consideration you have to approach for hyperconverged? That is a little more complicated compared to the traditional compute and storage layer separated each other. Because you need more CPU power, the hyperconverged consume CPU power, but honestly, in a remote office, CPU power is not a constraint, usually is not a constraint. For sure, you need more memory, because hyperconverged consume more memory. You have to consider also some part of the memory for the, let's say, the storage part. And then you have to choose the right storage, the right disks, maybe only a spinning disk or some kind of SSD. Now, with the cost of SSD, honestly, using some kind of spinning disk does not make more sense anymore, unless you are going to big spinning disk. So it can be really interesting, but if you need to optimize the cost, maybe you can still use also the spinning disk. And network card can be another point to be analyzed, because in hyperconverged solution, the backend bus, where usually all the storage part is managed, all the disks are pulled together. In this case, in hyperconverged, is the network. It's not only the network. Of course, it's the local SAS bus, but it's also the network. And you need the network to be fast enough to provide storage with reasonable latency. Otherwise, if the network is slow, you see huge latency in your storage. So one solution can be Virtual Sun. You probably know that Virtual Sun from VMware can be also used for remote office, and now there is also a SKU specific also for Virtual Sun, specific for Robo case, like the vSphere SKU, where you pay per VM, so it's really cheap if you want, compared to the socket license, if you want to build, let's say, 10 VM in your branch office. Of course, there are some aspects that you have to consider. Unless you are not using the new 6.5 version, actually, the network can be an issue. You don't really need 10 giga, but you want 10 giga to be sure that latency is good enough. But with 6.5, you can finally use cross cable. So you can use two nodes with just the high-speed card with a direct link, direct cable across the two nodes, so no need to have an external 10 giga switches. But the traffic, the vSAN traffic, is going to be at 10 giga. And this is a good solution, honestly, because you don't really know which kind of switches you can find in a remote office. because you can find also weak switches, maybe 1 giga switches, but really slow, worst performance. That can be good enough for virtual machine, but not for storage. If switches are not full switches, full speed switches, you can have delay or some kind of issue. Otherwise, a different approach, here the configuration for remote office in Virtual Sun, that is mostly a usual configuration of Virtual Sun where you have to add some option for the two nodes and the local traffic across the two nodes. A different solution can be use virtual machine to provide the storage capability, so to have some kind of virtual storage appliance. There are some specific solutions that can work in this way. Also some solution specific for robo scenario that can be great because of the cost, for example. Nothing so different from the first idea of VMware to start with a virtual machine. In this case, the nice aspect is that the witness, because in a two-node architecture, two-node cluster, you have also to think about where is your third part. You need a third part to avoid the split brain scenario. Where is it? Where is it? Usually in the central office. That's reasonable enough. If you have enough bandwidth, 1 mega can be enough, honestly, for shared for all the services, and not higher latency. I see reasonable latency across 200 milliseconds still works, but more of them, you can have some issue to have an external witness. If you also have some internal issue, of course. The nice aspect is that you can have this kind of witness that for Virtual Sun is just another ESXi. Can be virtual, but is an ESXi. And is one ESXi for each branch office. 8 giga minimum, recommended more, 8 giga of RAM just for a witness. That is a mess, honestly. So not so scalable from my point of view, of course. There are some documents where you can use, for example, a free hypervisor to build, but I don't like this approach. In this case, most of the specific solution for VSA using a virtual storage appliance, just have a really simple witness that is a service that you can add to your vCenter if you want. If you have a Windows-based vCenter server, is a Windows server, a Windows service. Otherwise, if you have the Linux appliance, you can just add a package in the Linux appliance to have a Linux service. And the nice aspect is that this kind of service just use few hundred of kilobyte of memory, so is really has a really low impact, and is just one for all the remote offices, so really scalable from this point of view. This is nice. The other nice aspect is that probably in this case you don't have a strictly requirements on the local disks. In Virtual Sun, at least you have to start for each node with one SSD, one flash disk, let's say, and one spinning disk, or another flash disk, if you want the full flash solution. Flash disk are becoming cheaper and cheaper, but still, compared to some spinning disk, costly. So, force the choice to have a flash solution, also if you don't really need flash solution, can be honestly a big constraint. In this case, you just need a local disk that can just work in some way. You can have also another interesting point of view. You can use, maybe you don't need, but you can use locally on each host some kind of disk with some kind of redundancy. Let's say RAID 5 for each node, like the first VSA from VMware. But why can be so important to have also local availability of your data? Because if you are building a two-node cluster, a two-node hyper-converged cluster, and you have one node in maintenance mode because you are doing some update, upgrade, or what else, what's happen if you lose one disk, one physical disk on the other system? It's a mess. You lose all your data in VirtualSun, because the availability is across the nodes, and you have one node not available. So all your data that you have changed are lost forever. It's not good. At least for the data, maybe have some kind of also local redundancy, considering that you have a two-node architecture that can be a huge risk. Of course, if you lose this node, you lose all the VM, but this is not so. This is a risk that maybe you can manage, but losing one disk of one node when the other one is in maintenance mode can be a mess for the data availability. So don't forget also this. For data protection, of course, you need to provide some kind of data availability and data protection using maybe backup solution, using the 3-2-1 rule to save a copy of your data, to have at least two copies of your data, three copies using the also the original, in two different media sets where at least one can be offsite. So the offsite, where is it? Can be the cloud, can be the central office, yes, but probably you need enough bandwidth. Do you have it? Yes, okay. It's fine, you can use replication. Otherwise, probably you still need the legacy implementation with tapes. That is not so funny, but probably yes, it depends. In Italy, we have a lot of remote office with low bandwidth. So tapes are the only solution to make easily off-site backup. You need to build an external backup server? Not necessary. With vSphere, you can use tape using pass-through SAS, for example, fast as a physical server. The VM Direct Path feature that is not so used, but in this case can be interesting because you can have one of the two nodes that has a pass-through card, a virtual machine dedicated for the backup. Of course, if you lose the second node, you lose temporarily the backup server, but you still have the data offsite, and you don't have to provide external additional hardware, just the local tape or an external tape connected to a SAS. That can be interesting. Otherwise, some kind of replication across the system. And a central backup management, yes, but only if the data across the central and the remote office are optimized. Otherwise, it can be really dangerous if you don't have high bandwidth. Let's say, for example, Vim Backup, until version 9, it wasn't optimize for remote office. You need to start at least with version 9, or of course 9.5, because there are some roles like the guest interaction and the mount repository role that can handle locally the huge data in the remote office and just send the remote command from the central station to the remote office. Still, bandwidth can be an issue because I see, for example, that the Vim console require a lot of bandwidth to be used remotely. If you want to use, for example, from the branch office, the remote console to talk to the main backup server, can be not so funny if you have very, very few bandwidth. And also, you have to consider that your solution maybe does not provide a good resiliency if you lose the network connectivity. Because, for example, for Vim, all the jobs, all the backup jobs are executed by the Vim backup that in this kind of architecture is in the central office. If you lose the connectivity, your job backup is no more available, cannot run. Maybe temporarily, there are some kind of retry commands, but the remote part, the remote roles of Vim in the branch office does not have the intelligence to run in all the jobs in a self way. They still need the central management to do this. Also, for very, very small cases, still 1 minute, sorry for the delay, there are some NAS that can provide also integrated backup capability. Of course, there are huge hyper-converged solution for backup like Cohesity or Rubrik that you can find here, but are interesting for big company. Probably they will go also for remote office building with virtual appliance or something else, but actually you can, if you have a very small limited solution, you can just build by one of these NAS and use some kind of backup program that can be installed, can install most of the roles inside the NAS system. That can be interesting if you don't want have a dedicated Windows server or virtual machine to handle the local part of the backups and just push your data outside to a NAS and put also the intelligence of part of the backup on the NAS. And finally, data security. We talked this morning about data security. Maybe you need encryption of the communication across the central office and the remote office, but this can be handled, for example, with MPLS or some kind of VPN, doesn't matter. But you still have local data that are usually in virtual machine, and how can you protect this kind of data? Finally, with version 6.5 of vSphere, you can use policy to protect virtual machine and virtual machine data, and this can be interesting. Otherwise, you have to find other type of solution, like encrypted file system or encrypted block or something else, or encrypted disk, but on servers are difficult to find. So with this, I finish my session. I hope that was not much boring or interesting enough. Thank you for your patience and have a good lunch.